Hey there, Dearborn Christian Fellowship. Pastor Brad here. Hope you had a great weekend. Hope you're having a great start to another week. As we seek to pursue Christ together throughout this week, having come out of our time of worship together yesterday, and then scattering as the church into the places that God has planted us throughout this week, so that we can live out the gospel in those places and seek to bring the kingdom of God to bear on every sphere of life. That's language that we use every week. And I hope in the repetition of that language, it begins to sink deep into your heart and your minds, that as we talk about living a life on mission, that that language begins to give you the context for what is meant by that. It means wherever we go, whatever we do, we don't do it as an end unto itself, but it is part of the life that God has given to us to live. And within it is the opportunity to be witnesses to the person and work of Jesus Christ, to the effects that the kingdom of God seeks to have on every part of life, healing most of all humanity's relationship with their creator, right? What we call salvation. Like, that's what we want to see those who don't yet know Christ come to experience. But there are so many other ways in which the kingdom of God comes to bear on all of life. Healing people in their view of themselves. Diseases, illnesses. Like, we see the advancement of medicine, catch this, as part of the advancement of the kingdom of God. As God, by his common grace, has enabled doctors and scientists and medical professionals tools and wisdom to figure out how his world works and, like, what are the ways in which our bodies can be healed and restored. All of that is kingdom work. Think about education. Like, we don't usually think about it this way, but, like, education is a tool that helps someone to live and thrive within society, within the world around them. One of the greatest causes of poverty in the world is a lack of education. And so kingdom work is done. It doesn't necessarily restore someone's salvation or, right, like, life with their father, but the kingdom of God coming more fully to the earth as human thriving happens on the earth, like the effects of the fall being kind of peeled away layer by layer, happens as poverty goes away, as food shortages are eliminated, as water shortages are eliminated. All these things are like kingdom of God work. It's not that someone's being saved by it, though we want to use those things as platforms ultimately to proclaim Jesus, right? The healing of that man in Acts 3 was the platform by which Peter then proclaimed the gospel and called people to repentance and faith. Remember, he didn't even point them to the healing. At the end of the day, he said, this Jesus is the way for eternal life to be obtained, right? So, like, it's all going to point to Jesus and the gospel, but the kingdom coming to earth is going to help all of the aspects of this world look more like the Garden of Eden did in Genesis 1 and 2, right? We're seeking to bring heaven to earth, the kingdom of God more fully to earth. And of course, that's what Jesus tells us to pray in the Lord's Prayer. Your kingdom come. How does that happen? It happens as his will is done, as it's lived out, as it's expressed in God-ordained and designed aspects of his world, on earth as it is in heaven. So may you live out the gospel in this week so that the kingdom of God is brought to bear on every sphere of life. We are in the Canons of Dort. We're making our way towards the end that we've got this week, and I'm going to use one more week to wrap up the I part of the TULIP acronym, the Irresistible Grace portion. And then in 2 weeks, we'll get into the perseverance of the saints, or the preservation of the saints, the P, which is basically, in summary, you can't lose your salvation. It's that topic. And we'll flesh that out both as a biblical truth and also a logical conclusion from the realities of unconditional election, irresistible grace, all these things that have been teaching us that salvation is the work of God, the gift of God, the grace of God into our life. And therefore, if God has given it, who are you to lose it? I mean, that's a very simple summary, and we'll get to that later on. Today, Irresistible Grace, we continue on with Article 15. The title of this one is Responses to God's Grace, okay? So here's what it says, and I'll just make some comments kind of as we go. God does not owe this grace to anyone. Okay, so this is, again, thinking about humanity has plunged ourselves into the state of sin. We are not sitting there begging God for his grace, and God owes it to no one. In fact, right, like the whole idea of fair, like if we want to be fair, what every person deserves is eternal separation from God. And so God owes no one anything, certainly not grace. For what could God owe to one, meaning to human, sinful humanity, who has nothing to give that can be paid back? Indeed, what could God owe to one who has nothing of his own to give but sin and falsehood? Therefore, the person who receives this grace owes and gives eternal thanks to God alone. Guilt, grace, gratitude. Sin, salvation, service. The life that has received the salvation that God has granted will now look to live in gratitude, which is seen in obedience, for the gracious salvation that God has given to us. The person who does not receive it either does not care at all about these spiritual things and is satisfied with himself and his condition, right? That's one of the things that I've said often. I actually heard somebody else say it once. Like, there's nobody who desires to be in relationship with God that won't be. Because the only way that you will be is because God has extended that grace into your life. So the person that has not received it does not care at all about these spiritual things and is satisfied with himself and his condition. Or else, here's another option, in self-assurance, foolishly boasts about having something which he lacks. And I will say, right, and First John talks about this. I was having this conversation with somebody the other day. There are many who, for a season of their life, gladly put themselves within the walls of a church and may even at times appear to be genuine disciples. And the book of Hebrews talks about this, and First John talks about this, and the reality is, and this is why we make a distinction between the visible church and the invisible church. The visible church is what we see happening, right? And we don't often call that into question because we don't see into the hearts and minds of individuals. It's going to talk about that in just a second here. So we don't see that. We kind of assume, we make assumptions, and this is on the shoulders of the elders, that by the profession, the outward profession of faith, that a person truly believes. But over time, the evidence of one's life will bear out whether that profession is genuine or not. And so what First John says is that there were many who went out from them. There were many who ended up leaving the church when they faced persecution, as we talked about yesterday. As the kind of the shiny excitement of the New Testament church kind of wore off, and now it became like, here's everyday life. Like, you have to believe these certain things about who Jesus is. It calls you to die to yourself, to live for the glory of God, all these things. And like, they start to see people walk away from the church. And what John says in First John is, they went out from us, but they were not truly of us. They were not truly of us. And so for a time, they self-assurance, they foolishly boasted about that, which in actuality they lacked. They thought they had salvation, but in reality, they hadn't received it. They were attracted to maybe aspects of the church and the gospel, community, fellowship, support, because those things should be attractive, right, to the world. But if there isn't genuine faith in Christ, in the end, you haven't actually obtained that which you think you have, and you'll end up walking out from it and will prove to have never truly been of it. It's not that you didn't lose, it's not that you lost your salvation, it's that you never truly had salvation. You were attracted to aspects of the gospel, but not the object of the gospel, Jesus. Okay, that was a lot on that little point. Furthermore, following the example of the apostles, and here's what I was talking about, we are to think and speak in the most favorable way about those who outwardly profess their faith and better their lives. So we should assume that those who profess Christ, those who are seeking to grow in their faith and mature as disciples, those who are part of the visible church, we should assume that they are also part of the invisible church, that they are genuine disciples, because the inner chambers of the hearts are unknown to us. We can't be sure about that. But for others who have not yet been called, I love that language, not yet been called, doesn't mean they're not going to be called. We don't know the plan of God. We don't know the mind of God. But as of this point, they have not yet been called. We are to pray. We spent 40 days starting out this year praying to the God who calls things that do not exist as though they did. In no way, however, are we to pride ourselves as better than they are, as though we had distinguished ourselves from them, right? The message of the gospel is always humility, or I should say the effects of the gospel are always humility, a recognition that this is the work of God in my life. And so I'm not better than someone who's not called. I'm the object of God's mercy and compassion and grace. And I need to pray for those who have not yet been called, that God would call those who have not yet been called as though they were, and would do that same regenerative work in their life as they've done, as he's done in mine. And then Article 16 speaks to regeneration's effect. Okay, this is, I love this because it starts to talk about fruit, okay, and a life of obedience and why our obedience matters. So here's what it says. However, just as by the fall man did not cease to be man, endowed with intellect and will, and just as sin, which has spread through the whole human race, did not abolish the nature of the human race, but distorted and spiritually killed it, right? That's the effect of the fall. It didn't get rid of our wills. It distorted our will. It killed us spiritually, so that now we have a distorted will, right? We've talked about that. Like, it's not that we don't have free will. Free will means you can always act in accordance with your will. The problem is that in the fall, our wills died. Our wills were spiritually killed and distorted. So also, this divine grace of regeneration does not act in people as if they are blocks or stones. Sometimes you hear that criticism. Well, if election is true, then human beings are just robots. We're just robots. That's not the way we're supposed to think about it. Okay, we're not blocks or stones, nor does it abolish the will and its properties or coerce a reluctant will by force. Okay, so it's not, again, that would be a violation of our will. That would then say we don't have a free will, because what I desire to do is continue to live in sin, but God is forcing me unto himself. God is forcing me to have this healed will, that or this response of faith, which I don't want to do. No, we're not being coerced. We're not reluctant. Instead, what God is doing is he's healing us. This is what we've said, right? And here's that specific language. But spiritually revives, heals, reforms, and in a manner at once pleasing and powerful, bends it back. He does for us what his grace alone could do, and take that which has been distorted and killed by sin, and he raises it back to life. He heals our will so that now our eyes can be open and we can see clearly the difference between that bowl of manure and that bowl of ice cream, right? Like we talked about a few weeks ago. If that doesn't make sense, you got to back up a couple videos and watch the other analogy of that. But now if I can see clearly, my will is healed, and guess what I am always going to choose, irresistibly so? The ice cream, never the manure. Are you going to bite in that manure? Once you see the difference between God and life and death and Satan, what are you going to choose? You're going to choose God. You're going to respond with faith. You're going to come with hearts of gratitude and faith in Christ. It's a healed will, a will that's been bent back to the original design of its creator. Okay, and as a result, a steady and sincere obedience of the Spirit now begins to prevail. Where before, the rebellion and resistance of the flesh were completely dominant. It is in this that the true and spiritual restoration and freedom of our will consists. So, free will, yes. But we got to define what that means. Free will as an autonomous, I can choose or resist God. That's not the way the scripture talks about a free will. A free will is a will that can act in accordance with its nature. And a will that has been healed according to the way it was created by its creator is a will that will respond with faith and trust in the gospel. A will that has been killed and distorted by sin is going to respond with rebellion and resistance. Thus, if the marvelous maker of every good thing were not dealing with us, and praise God, he does deal with us, but if he would not, man would have no hope of getting up from his fall by his free choice, by which he plunged himself into ruin when still standing upright. So that's what we mean by the freedom of the will. And the bondage of the will. Two, Martin Luther wrote one, John Owens, I think, wrote the other. Freedom of the will, bondage of the will. How can those both be true? Well, we have a free will that since the fall of humanity is in bondage to and slavery to sin. But once God heals that will, it continues to be free, but now can respond with faith in the God who by his grace has extended that freedom or that healing into our hearts, regenerating our hearts so that we could see Christ clearly and come to him by faith. And so pray for yourself, pray for those whose will has not yet been healed, that God might call them as he has called you, and live in gratitude, knowing that apart from God, we'd be so lost, but by his grace, he has called us to himself and we've been able to respond with faith and find salvation. What a glorious God. When that's the truth, God gets all the glory. God gets all the praise. And from that, he'll get lives that seek to love him and live in obedience because of all that he has done for us. Have a great week loving and serving your King, and I'll see you on Sunday.